there who he is, that he is Lord, that he is our Savior. When we do that this morning, we accomplish the mission. It's the reason why we gather, is for him to exalt his name. And I hope you guys are ready to do that this morning. And it's going to start with baptism.
Good morning. It's always exciting to celebrate when someone makes a decision in their life like baptism. It's that outward testimony. So I'm going to ask Jenna Hartsock if she'll go ahead and come up here and join me, because she loves standing in front of groups of people. So I want to just read just a little bit of what our manual says. As baptism is the sign and seal of the new covenant of grace, the significance of which is attested by the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Romans. The earliest and simplest statement of Christian belief, into which you now come to baptism, is the Apostles' Creed. What we know as the Apostles' Creed is this earliest statement of faith. And so I'd like to read that before we go any further this morning. It says this: I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Church of Jesus Christ, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. So, Jenna, do you acknowledge Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Will you agree to be baptized into this faith of statement we just read? And will you obey God and follow his commands all the days of your life? Awesome. We're going to get ready, and then y'all going to have some announcements, and we'll have a baptism.
Let's pray. Jesus, this day right here is for you. God, we're asking for your name to be praised, for you to receive the glory for everything that happens in this place today. God, we have a chance to go out after this and continue to prove who you are by the way that we live, by the way that we love, by the way that we reach into our neighbors' lives. And as we go, Lord, you've called us to bring you with us and spread the good news, because people need good news, and we're the plan to send the good news into this world. So God, we need your strength to do that. We need your word to do that. We need to be filled with your Spirit in order to do that. So God, this morning, as we get ready to baptize Jenna, as we get ready to worship you, as we get ready to celebrate your goodness this morning, God, we say that you're good, that you're mighty, that you're powerful, that you're worthy, that you alone are worthy of this praise this morning. And this is for you. So we thank you, Jesus. Amen. Let's have some announcements.
Church VBS starts on July 25th, so if you haven't signed up now, you're going to want to sign up soon, because it's going to be a party. Group, I love to dance, so let's dance. On August 7th, during both services, Pastor Rich would like to bless your backpack.
Pastor Rich is going to give you a blessing.
I think I can do that.
I think you can do that. If you bring him with you on August 7th, Pastor Rich is going to lay a blessing before you go back to school. Thank you.
Backpack.
Backpack. Hey, folks. Pizza with the Pastor is coming up August 14th, right after Second Service. If you are new to the church since, like, forever, or if you haven't been to a Pizza with the Pastors, or if you're hungry, you should come. We'll get to know a little bit about you. You can get to know us and maybe ask some questions about the church, and we'll have some time of fellowship, and we'll get to know each other a little bit better. So join us then, August 14th, right after Second Service, in the youth room. Thanks.
Come on, do we need another reason to celebrate? Let's stand. I've got a new song to teach you this morning. It is the Lord. Are you familiar with the Lord's Prayer? Because we're about to sing it in a new way. I'm gonna sing it for you. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Here's the chorus. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us, as we forgive the ones who've sinned against us. Forgive them. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. You guys ready? Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us, as we forgive the ones who've sinned against us. Forgive them, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us, as we forgive the ones who've sinned against us. Forgive them, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. It's yours, all yours, the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. It's yours, all yours, forever and ever, the kingdom is yours. It's yours, all yours, all yours, the kingdom, the power, the glory. it's yours, all yours, all yours, forever, forever, the kingdom is yours. Father, let your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven. Right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven. Right here in my heart. Praise the Lord this morning. Let his will be done. His will in our lives. That's what we're here for. That's what we're after. Jesus, help us to do that.
I am surrounded on every side, can see the light of day. I am persuaded beyond all hope, you won't let go of me.
I stake my claim on every word you say, you will not be late. I will sing through fire and thunder, 'cause you are on my side. I trust you in my life. I know my story isn't over. Even against all odds, you are a faithful God. Darkest of weather, though I can't see, I still believe you're good. So I'm moving forward through crashing waves. I know I'm safe with you. You hold my life, you hear my cry with every breath inside. Trust you in my life. I know my story, it isn't over. Even against all odds, you are a faithful God. That's who you are. You are a faithful God.
Will
hold together, and I will dwell in your love. I will sing through fire and thunder, 'cause you are on my side. I trust you in my life. I know my story, it isn't over. Even against all odds, you are a faithful God. That's who you are. You are a faithful God. Oh, you're faithful God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name this morning. Of our praise this morning, Jesus. You are good, you are powerful, and yet gracious and loving and kind all at the same time. Receive our worship. of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name, worthy. Jesus, the only one you could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Upon your love, it is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
So we pray together. This is Mission Clarksville Week, and we just sang a song that said, God, lead me, lead my heart to those around me, to love those around me. We get a chance to do that this week. And I'll just admit, other pastors are awesome, and they have perfect hearts, and they're always thinking of others. But I can be selfish, and I can be lazy, and I can want to stay in the air conditioning. But Jesus goes before me, and if I follow Jesus, we go where he goes. We love those who he loves. We have a heart for those that Jesus has a heart for. So we get to work. So pray this week specifically for Mission Clarksville. Miss Virginia over here, the very nice lady in the blue t-shirt, and Pastor Charlotte are leading us this week. And so right after church today, you can stick around, you can have lunch, and then we're going to go down to Grace House and work today. We've got projects Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. This week, we get to put legs on the church this week, specifically this week, but all the time. But pray for Mission Clarksville this week. We've got so many things and folks to be praying for today. We've got the Mortimers. This is their last Sunday with us. So Pastor Mike and April and the kids are going to be starting in a new church up in Cincinnati. So pray for Pastor Mike as they transition. The Tafflingers had their first Sunday in Saipan. Actually, it was yesterday as we're speaking right now because it's nearly 1 o'clock in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. But Chad and Angela and the kids had church today, and they had a lot of children there specifically. Not all their luggage is there, but they're there. So pray for Chad and Angela as they begin their new adventure. We have baby Harper is here. Wave, Harper. Hey, how's it going? Good to meet you. I'll come bother you later. But that's Harper. And then we also have baby Cinderella is still in the hospital, I believe. But Rob and Abby, little baby Lydia was born yesterday morning. Keep praying for Dale's daughter, Nikki, 25 weeks, give or take, 26. So pray for that little baby. Pray for Dale's daughter, Nikki. Keep praying for Frank Miller, Dylan and Ginger Barnett, Virginia Justice, Russell was taken to the hospital yesterday. Let's pray for Russ. Pray for Chris Blackwell. Many of you know Debbie and Bill's son, Chris. He had COVID a while back, and now that has reflected some heart issues unrelated to his sickness. But Chris is undergoing more tests down in Nashville. Let's pray together with them. That and many other personal needs that you have, that I have, let's go to our Savior this morning. Let's talk to Jesus. Lord, we thank you for this day. Thank you for this church. Thank you, God, for my brothers and sisters in Christ. We get to come together, turn our eyes, turn our attention, turn our affection toward you in a unique way on Sunday mornings. I get to do this every moment of every day. I can pray, I can worship, I can think about you, I can long for you, I can put my hope in you, but I don't get to do it with this many people except on Sunday mornings as we gather together. So God, thank you for this privilege of being together as we've lifted up your name in praise, as we pray and call out to you, as we've celebrated Jenna's baptism and here in second service, Braden's baptism. God, as we bring our needs before you, and in just a moment, we're going to look into your written word and listen for your voice as you speak to us. God, thank you for the privilege of being together. God, the names that we've called out from the youngest to the oldest, the names we've called out to you today, Lord, we just say, Lord, here are our needs. We have such great needs. Some, Lord, some needs are very personal and we barely share them with anyone because it's just too close and too personal. Some needs we're very open about, but God, you know all of it. So, Lord, from our relationships and our marriages with our kids and grandkids, with our finances, where we work, in our communities, our bodies, Lord, we bring all of these things to you. And we say, God, here are the things that are weighing us down. You've promised to come and be near us and that we could share our burdens with you and that you would be with us and walk with us. So God, we do that again today. We bring you our needs. Lord, bless this service. We believe that you are here. Where two or three are together in your name, you are here. So you are here, and you're going to be here this afternoon. As the church gathers and works with Mission Clarksville, you're going to be here tomorrow morning as we come together and as we go out into our community. You're going to be down near Austin Peay on Wednesday as we go and spend the day with our friends in Lincoln Homes. God, you are the hands and feet of Jesus in me, in us. Do great things this week through your people. Lord, we love you. We thank you for all that you do. In your great name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. It's good to see you. Hey, how's it going? It's good to see you. If you've been here 1,000 times, it's good to see you again. If this is your very first time in church, howdy. My name's Rich. We'd love to have you back. Okay, we have two services on Sunday at 9:30 and 11, and we would love to have you back. If you don't have a home church that you attend regularly, we'd love for you to be back. Jenna was baptized here in first service. Braden Jackson, another one of our teenagers, is going to be baptized in second service, so we celebrate that together. Mission Clarksville starts right after second service today, so we're going to have a meal together, and then we're going to be working down at Grace House throughout this day. And then Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday mornings, we meet here at 8 o'clock. We'd love for you to come. Be here at 8 o'clock. We've got mission projects at YAPAC, working with our homeless folks here in Clarksville at the Salvation Army. And then Wednesday, we're going to be going out and spending time with the kids out at Lincoln Homes, the kids and the families at Lincoln Homes. So I hope you will participate. Wednesday night, we will not have midweek services here. We will not meet for Bible study or children's church. We are meeting, those of you who want to participate, they're going to have a goodbye service for a goodbye party for April and Micah Mortimer, and everybody's invited to that. If you'd like to come and participate in that, that's Wednesday night, but we're not having regular midweek services because of Mission Clarksville. We're collecting stuff for back-to-school items. We're collecting tissues and hand sanitizer over these last couple of weeks and this week, so if you'd want to bring any of those. Vacation Bible School is in 2 weeks, starts 2 weeks from tomorrow, and if you could help Pastor Rochelle out by signing up, if you're going to volunteer, if you're an adult type person, and you're going to volunteer for VBS, we'd love to know in advance, so you can sign up on the tables out in the foyer. And I said that, and I said that, and I said that. Okay, we're going to receive an offering this morning. We sent 80 kids and teens to camp this summer. So 4 weeks of camp, we had 55 teens and 25 children go to camp this summer. And part of the way we sent them and helped them was through our anniversary offering. So here are a few heavyweights. You ready? Mike and Virginia Bridges have celebrated 33 years of marriage. Well done, kids. Dick and Myung Noggle have been married 44 years. Well done. And Brian and Jeannie Preston would have been married 40 years today. Jeannie went to be with Jesus on May 1st. Is that correct? May 1st. But Brian's here today, and he wanted to recognize their anniversary. So we praise God with them as well. Let's pray together. Father, we love you today. We thank you for the privilege to be a part of your people. Your kingdom comes to Clarksville as it is in heaven. God, bless this day, this service, this time together. And Lord, through this act of worship, as we bring back to you our offerings and your tithe, God, take these gifts and build your kingdom. In your great name we pray. Amen. Ready? This is the follow the leader. Okay. Everybody do this. Okay. Can you see it? It's right around the corner. Next Sunday is the very end of this Sermon on the Mount series. We've been in the Sermon on the Mount since the first Sunday of January, and you can see it. You can see it. It's right around the corner. It's next Sunday. We finish up Matthew chapter 7. Are you familiar with the five love languages? Okay, some of you are, some of you are not. Some smart person wrote a book called The Five Love Languages, and the idea is that we all experience love and give love specifically in five different ways. And I'm sure there are subcategories off in each one of these, but in five different ways we show love and five different ways we feel love. And here are the five. And just as I, if you're a married person, if you've ever had, you know, a junior high school crush, if you have friendships at work, in your life, your relationships, we all share love in different ways. We all feel and receive love in different ways. And these were the five that this author came up with. Quality time. Okay, I would look around. We could do hands, but we won't do that. So quality time. Acts of service. I do something for you. Physical touch. Romantic touch or just brotherly love touch. Words of affirmation. Words, speaking, encouragement, that kind of thing. And gifts, receiving gifts. And the idea is that I can express love to Dana in my love language, but if that's not Dana's love language, it's an awfully nice sentiment, but it doesn't land. If I'm a gifts person, which I'm not, are you telling me to shh? Okay, that's awesome, because you just went like this, shh, and I got quiet real quick. Sorry, that was just a little moment between me and Kim. Okay, I thought I was saying the wrong thing. Okay, so I can, if I'm a gifts person, and I like to receive gifts, and I bombard Dana early on in our courtship and early on in our marriage, if I keep bringing her flowers and it doesn't land, that could be because that's my love language but not hers. So think about it for a minute. What's your love language? How do you express love when you want to tell somebody how much they mean to you, whether it's a romantic thing or a couples thing or a marriage thing? How do you express love? And is that the love language of your partner, the one receiving that, your wife, your husband, your spouse? And so Dane and I have been familiar, you know, generally familiar with the five love languages for a long time, and they've got little assessments you can do on your phone and all that kind of stuff. But my top two, and I'm a dude, and it's kind of stereotypical, but guys are physical touch largely, not all of us, not top all the time, but my number two, a close number two, is physical touch. So every once in a while, even just we're driving down the road and Dana will reach over and she'll just put her hand on the back of my head, and I would embarrass her and say, Dana, what do I do when you do that? But she reaches over, she'll touch the back of my head, and I always go like a, you know, I'll lean into that. Give me some of that. Okay. So that's my number two. My number one is words. Words can lift me up. Words can cut me down quickly. I can be greatly encouraged by words, and I can be sliced up very quickly with words. If you go to Pago Pago and bring me back a coffee mug, awesome, thanks. But that's not going to mean nearly as much to me as if you come up to me and give me words of encouragement. And Dana has her own love languages, and I'm not going to tell any of you what it is, because I don't want, that's, okay, that's for me to know. So we express love. Now, as we go to Matthew 7, as we look at this passage that we're looking at today, for some reason early this week, I just got fixated on this question. What would be God's love language? Because there are times that we express love, what we assume to be love for God, But we're doing what we want to do. We're choosing to say what we want to say, but it might not be what God has actually said. Here's how you can show me that you love me. And we're going to look at that a little bit today. So at the in chapter 7 in the book of Matthew, it starts with don't judge harshly, don't judge quickly, don't give condemnation. Ask and seek and knock, that's bringing our needs to God. The narrow gates, the wide road. Last week we looked at true and false prophets, and today we're looking at true and false disciples. And these, just three verses today, but they're kind of harsh. And as we read these verses, I want you to ask yourself, does the way I express being a follower of Jesus sync with what Jesus has actually told me to do and how he wants me to love him? If you'd like to, you can stand this morning in honor of God's word. Matthew chapter 7, starting in verse 21, says this: "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven." Now that's serious. Probably like me, you all have been trained whenever we see the word heaven, we think of die and go to heaven. But over these last few weeks, we've been talking about the kingdom of heaven. That's where God rules. God can rule Clarksville in 2022. And he can start that in my life at my house. And so it's not just the someday off in the distant, you know, bright blue yonder heaven, but it's the kingdom that is at work right now. "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who's in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons? And in your name perform many miracles?' But then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.'" Ouch. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You can be seated. This is serious. Jesus, the one who loves us. Jesus, the one who left the 99 to find you. Jesus, the one who says that we can hear his voice and recognize his voice. Jesus, the one who came to save us, says that not everyone who says, "Lord," will be a part of the kingdom. So if there are some tells here, we want to pay attention to what Jesus is saying here. Not everyone who calls Jesus Lord is a true disciple. Just because you say he is doesn't make it so. Everyone who is a, get this, I didn't write this, but I thought this was clever. Not everyone who is a professor, I profess, is a possessor. See what I did there, Daryl? That's awesome. I didn't write that, but that's awesome. Not everyone who is a professor is a possessor. Matthew chapter 15, just over a couple of pages. Matthew chapter 15, verse 8. Jesus says, "The people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." Now, maybe you've been around Christian people long enough to have met folks like this. They say the right things. We say that we follow Jesus. We say that, you know, we give some outward signs. We're at church a lot. We teach a class. We participate in lots of things. But their hearts reflect, like Jesus says, they profess it, but it just doesn't seem like they possess it. Not everyone who says, "Lord," will be a part of the kingdom. Only those, go back to chapter 7, Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do the will of my Father who is in heaven. So what is the will of our Father in heaven? What does Jesus say? What does he want? What does Jesus really want for us to do? We can come up with our own what Jesus wants. Jesus wants me. I mean, look at the list he gave. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Is there anything wrong with prophesying in Jesus' name? No. Many will say that many have driven out demons or perform miracles. Those are pretty outstanding things to do. But they're professors and not possessors. Only those who do the will of the Father. In John's Gospel, in chapter 14, John chapter 14, in verse 15, Jesus starts this little section of Scripture, and it says this, if you love me, keep my commands. Now, we're all familiar, again, with commandments, right? There's 10 of them. There's way more, but there starts with 10 of them. Book of Exodus, thou shalt not, do these things. Jesus says, if you love me, if you're going to be a true disciple, if you love me, you'll keep my commands. What are the commands of Jesus? Boy, I hate to beat this gong again, but it comes back to one word, two commands from Jesus, but one word, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. If you do this, you follow Jesus. If you don't do this, then you're just doing stuff. John chapter 14, verse 15, if you love me, keep my commands. Verse 21, whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. Verse 23, anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. Are you familiar with Francis Chan? He's a teacher, author, pastor named Francis Chan, and he put it like this. You remember the game Simon Says? Simon Says, touch your head. Simon Says, pat your shoulders. Simon Says, touch your knees. Simon Says, do this, and you do it. Remember? He says it like this. It's weird how in the church, Jesus says is a totally different game. If Jesus says something, you don't have to do it, you just memorize it. You study it, you gather together with other believers and you talk about it, you put it on t-shirts, you find radio stations that talk about it, but you don't actually have to do it. He says, if I tell my daughter, hey, Rachel, go clean your room, she doesn't come back to me 2 hours later and say, I memorized what you said. You said, Rach, go clean your room. I can say it in Greek. My friends are going to come over later and we're going to sit at the table and we're going to talk about what it would look like if I actually cleaned my room. Why is it that when Jesus says very plainly, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, how can we tell that we do that? Thank you for asking. By loving your neighbors as yourself. We show God our love for him by how we treat others. We show God our love for him by loving those that he loves. If you want to show your love for me, you love my kids. If you want to show your love for me, do something for Jackson or Grant. If you want to show your love for me, be good to Dana. And if my brain works like that, I think God's brain works like that. Jesus says in Matthew 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those that do my Father's will. Many will say on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Didn't we drive out demons and in your name perform many miracles? But this is Jesus talking. But then I will say to them plainly, I never knew you. Church, you good Sunday morning people, don't you want to know? Don't we want to know if we're off the path? Don't we want to know if we're far more fixated on doing the stuff? The outward things that we can kind of put our fingers on, but we're empty inside because at the end of the day, we're doing good things, but we really don't have love that is driving them. So, Rich, are we saved by works? No. All right. So read all that Paul wrote, everything that Paul wrote in the New Testament. No, we are not saved by works. We are saved by grace through faith. We're not saved because I cast out demons or perform miracles or prophesy in his name. You can do all those things and be empty. Are we saved by works? No. The false disciples had works, but they did the works without the Spirit of Jesus on the inside of them. We're saved by Jesus. We're saved by Jesus. When we're saved by Jesus, there will be fruit. I had a discussion with one of our leaders here in the church just a couple of months ago, and we sat down and we talked about how do we know that people really are Christian? How do we know? How do we know that they are walking with Jesus? How do we know that they are disciples? How do we know? Some churches, and if this is your background, if this is who you are, how you were raised, God bless you. Okay, we're not the only ones that follow Jesus. But some people can count very easily. If we can count you that you've come to the altar and prayed, one, check. If five people come, five people are brand new Christians today, five checks. Some people count baptisms. Okay, we're going to have two new baptisms today. Praise God. But you know how you tell? Time. Time tells. Time tells. It's when people come and pray and put their faith in Christ, that's a step one. Praise God. God's done a whole lot of work before you ever get to this moment, and this is where we are beginning to agree with what God is doing in our lives. If you haven't started that journey, you can today. We're going to come in just a moment. We're going to come to the table, and you can come and literally receive Jesus today and start that walk with him. But as we were talking, me and one of our board members, we were talking one day, how can you tell? I somehow my brain worked like this. I can sit down and talk David into signing up for a marathon. Can't I, David? Okay. I can intellectually arm wrestle you and talk about how great it would be if we both signed up for the Nashville Marathon coming up this spring. And when he goes online and fills out the registration and pays his money and tells them what size of t-shirt he wears, that is a measurable moment, like praying at the altar, meeting with a pastor, sitting down and praying over coffee somewhere. That's a measurable moment. But how can we tell if they're really doing the work of discipleship? Early morning, Monday morning, when David's out running his neighborhood. And then Wednesday morning, when he's out running his neighborhood. And then Friday morning, when he runs a little bit shorter, because Saturday morning is the long run. And you start out those long runs at 4 miles. And then a week later, you go to 5 miles. And then a week later, you go to 6. And then you rest for a minute. And then 2 weeks later, you come back and you do 7. And then you do 8. And you run Monday, Wednesday, Friday, a little bit shorter, Saturday, long run, because Friday night you ate spaghetti. See, I can talk you into running a marathon, and that's great. That's a great first step. But we'll see whether you or I follow through on it. That's a little bit how we see discipleship. Jesus came and said, hey, I saw you sign up, but I haven't seen you do anything since then. How do we know There's a difference between obedience and lordship, or just deeds, acts. Jesus didn't say anything about ask me into your heart. Now, that's a picture that we use. And I've said that and I've preached that and I'll say it 100 more times. We need to ask Jesus to come and be in us, live in us, work in us, start that work. But Jesus never in the scripture and in the New Testament, nobody ever said, every eye closed, every head bowed, every hand, you know, held together, and let's pray. And there is no sinner's prayer in the Bible, and there is no ask Jesus into your heart in the Bible. Jesus says, follow me. What I do, you do. The places I go, you should go. The broken, the last, the least, and the lost that I go and love, you should love. By the way, you get a chance to do that this week, Mission Clarksville. Loving the people that Jesus loved. If we want to show Jesus that we love him, we love his kids, our brothers and sisters in Christ. It's about doing. It's more than just words. It's more than just signing up for the marathon. It's doing the work. And it's best done, learned with a teacher or a friend or a brother or sister in Christ. And here's a thought that we'll talk about a little bit more next week as we wrap up this series. It's better caught than taught. And to catch something, you need to be exposed to the virus. If you want to catch what it means to truly be a disciple of Jesus, hang out with some disciples of Jesus. I can stand here at this very nice podium and lecture you. I can teach some things that are in a book, but to truly know what it means to look like to follow Jesus, we need to spend time with those who are following Jesus, and we just kind of pick up on it. That's why Jesus didn't say, here's stuff, believe this stuff. He said, follow me. See what I do. Go where I go. Those who rest on good deeds, great deeds, I prophesied in your name. I cast out demons. I taught Sunday school for 45 years. I was on the church board. I was the one who came every week to fill up the baptistry that kept leaking. That's Brenda, by the way. She did that. We've got a baptistry, and the water should be here. So poor Jenna doesn't have to go down here to the level of the water. There's stuff to do, and we can get very proud of all the stuff we do, but our faith doesn't rest on great deeds. But wait, I do the stuff. It's almost like Paul had that in mind when in 1 Corinthians 13 he said, if I speak in the tongue of men and of angels, but I don't have love, I'm just a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. It's just noise. If I have the gift of prophecy, isn't that what Jesus just said in Matthew chapter 7? If I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all mysteries and knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. If I give everything I have to the poor, or if I give my body over to hardship, that I may boast, but I don't have love, I gain nothing. Like Francis Chan said, he goes to his daughter and he says, Rachel, go clean your room. She comes back later and says, I memorized what you said. What did Jesus tell us to do? Love our Heavenly Father. How? By loving those around us. By loving his kids. When we say that, it's like signing up for a marathon. When we do that, that's true discipleship. What are the commands of Jesus? Love God, love others. How do we know that God's love is in us? Go and read the rest of 1 Corinthians 13. It gives us some pretty good direction. Is that how you love your spouse? Is that how you love your neighbor? Is that how you love your friends? Is that how you love your enemies? If not, you've still got some discipleship work to do, and so do I. We can know Jesus better and deeper when we experience the life of the family of God. It's easier caught than taught. So here's the next step. We're going to come to the table in just a minute. And here's good news. Because of Jesus, you've all been adopted into the family of God. And there's room for you at the table. And you get to be included in on the family business. We'll talk more about that next week. You get to have a seat at the table that Jesus sets for us. You're invited. But Jesus doesn't just ask for a one-off. Come and say a prayer, come and take communion, and then carry on as if nothing has changed. We love our Heavenly Father by how we love those that are around us. And that is the proof of a true disciple. I don't like this. This is one of many passages that I don't really like, because I don't like when Jesus says that I could be wrong. But when Jesus said, this is the proof of your walk with me, if you love one another. Sometimes it's just easier to do the stuff. But the stuff without love for God is empty, it's noise, and it gains me nothing. There's more. And you're invited to be a part of the kingdom. I've asked a few people to come and help me serve this morning, if you would come today. And if you would stand up with me. If you'd like to this morning, you're invited to come and receive. As you come, you can step out of your sections in just a moment to your right. You can go over here. Thanks, Zoe. You can step out of your sections to your right and come forward and receive the bread and the cup. Hold on to it. We'll receive communion together. If you'd like to this morning, if this is your first time, if this is your 1,000th time, you're invited to come to his table today. Would you come today?
Sky, traced out by the city lights, my world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight, touchdown.
Would you stand with me? So amazingly, Jesus sets the table and he invites me. Now, there are a lot of clubs that I have no business belonging to, but somehow he invites me to be a part of his family. And the more time I am with him, the more time I am with those that he loves, the more time I'm with the family, I see what it is like to follow him. And sometimes those are high highs. Sometimes those are low and suffering. Sometimes Jesus leads us to great need to deepen our dependence on him. Sometimes he stretches me in ways that I wish he wouldn't. But he's building my faith. That's easier done together. On the night that our Lord was betrayed, he gathered his disciples together, and as they celebrated the Passover, he took bread. And when he had blessed it, he broke it and he passed it to his disciples, saying, "This bread is my body, and it's broken for you. As often as you come together and share this meal, do this. Eat my body, receive me, and remember me. Take and eat this morning, and be thankful." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had blessed it, he passed it around to his disciples, and he said, "This is my blood shed for you, poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins, so you can be with me and know me and live with me and for me. As often as you come together and share this meal, remember me. Take, drink this morning and receive Christ." Our Father, we thank you that you loved us enough to send us Jesus so we would know what God looks like, what God is like, what he sounds like, what he does, where he goes, how he loves, so that we, through the power of your Holy Spirit and through the encouragement of our brothers and sisters in Christ, we can spread out all over the world and show a world that you love, the God that we love. Thank you, God, that your kingdom comes, not just here inside of this church. Your kingdom comes to Clarksville as it is in heaven. And we get the opportunity to be a part of what you're doing. We get an opportunity to be true disciples, not just doing the stuff, performing the things, and doing the things that we want to brag about, but we get to go where you go. We get to go and love like you loved. We get to go and share words of hope and peace and joy that you shared. We get to go and make broken things new again through your great power. Lord, thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the privilege of being a part of your family. Thank you that we can know this morning, because of love, love for God and love for others, that we are true disciples and not just going through motions. Lord, speak to each one of us. Call us deeper and closer to you, into your family. In your great name we pray. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Like no other, I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived are good, Jesus. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrendered now, I'll give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrendered now, I'll give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Faithful. And all my life you have been faithful. Been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. Father, you are good. Father, we started out the service by reminding ourselves how good you are. And Lord, now we know a little bit more on how you want us to be. So help us to walk it out. Help us to do that for you and with you because of you. And in the way we follow Jesus, your kingdom will come with us. Help us, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Let's sing the doxology this morning together. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Amen. Okay, so here's your homework. Ready? 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 We finish up next week. And between now and next Sunday, here's what I want you to do. I'll give you a choice. Either you can go back and read the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, or you can go back and rewatch every single one of my sermons. They are conveniently packaged on YouTube. There's only about 25 of them. I figure that's about 14 hours of Rich Cook's very special preaching. Okay? So you can take your choice. But as we come together next Sunday, we'll bring this in for a landing, and Jesus gives us such a great picture of what it looks like to be a part of bringing his kingdom. Amen. And how that can make a difference in you than through you. So I hope that you'll be with us next Sunday. Would you let me bless you as you go today? May the God of hope fill you with all peace and joy as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. God bless you as you go.